Hello friends, today I am going to discuss about various stationary phases and mobile phases used in column chromatography. In my earlier videos, I have already discussed about various techniques of column chromatography and different types of column chromatography. So here, first I am going to discuss about stationary phases. So in column chromatography, commonly used stationary phases are sucrose, starch, annulin, talc, calcium carbonate, calcium phosphate, magnesia and silica gel, magnesium silicate, alumina and charcoal. These are the list of adsorbents used in column chromatography according to their affinity. Means sucrose is the weakest stationary phase and charcoal is the strongest stationary phase. Means adsorbing capacity will be highest in charcoal. Now I am going to enlist all these adsorbents. So first one is sucrose. Second one is starch. Third one is annulin. Fourth one is talc. Fifth one is calcium carbonate. Sixth one is calcium phosphate. Seventh one is magnesia. It is also known as magnesium oxide. Eighth one is silica gel. Ninth one is magnesium silicate. And next one, that is 10th, is alumina. And the last one is charcoal. Okay, so these are the adsorbents used in column chromatography. Sucrose is the weakest adsorbent. Then adsorbing capacity is increased gradually. And the charcoal is the strongest adsorbent. Okay. So first one is sucrose C12H22O11. Second one is starch C5H10O5N. Third one is annulin C6NH10N+2. Then O5N+1. Next one is talc. That is Mg3SI4O10, then OH whole twice. Next one is calcium carbonate, that is CaCO3. Next one is calcium phosphate, that is CaH2PO4 whole twice. Next one is magnesia or magnesium oxide, that is Mg. Next one is silica gel, that is SiO2. Next one, silica gel is most commonly used in stationary phase in column chromatography. Next one is magnesium silicate, that is MgO, then X represents to any number, then SiO2. After that alumina, that is Al2O3. Alumina is second most useful stationary phase in column chromatography. And the last one is charcoal, that is carbon. Okay. So all adsorbents used in column chromatography is polar in nature, that is why this is normal phase chromatography, so adsorbents are polar and mobile phase will be non-polar. So by using this technique, if we are doing separation by column chromatography by using these adsorbents, then first non-polar compound will be separated because these are polar stationary phase and they will retain the polar compounds. So I am giving the list of compounds according to their separation or according to their affinity. So by using this column chromatography, first alkyl halide will be separated. After alkyl halide, saturated hydrocarbon will be separated. After saturated hydrocarbon, unsaturated hydrocarbons will be separated. After unsaturated hydrocarbon, ethers will be separated. Here you can see alkyl halide is most non-polar material. After that, polarity is increasing. After ether, esters will be separated. After ester, ketones will be separated. After ketones, amines will be separated. After amines, alcohols will be separated. After alcohol, phenols will be separated. And after phenols, acids will be separated. So here alkyl halide is the least polar compound or highly non-polar compound, and acid is highly polar compound or highest polar compound. That is why for acid will be retained by column or adsorbents, means it will attach with adsorbents and it will be separated at the end, or it will be eluted at the last. And alkyl halide will be least attached with stationary phase. That is why alkyl halide will elute out first. Okay, now coming to the characteristics of adsorbents in column chromatography. So adsorbent should not go for any reaction with analyte, and it should not be catalyzed. Adsorbent should have uniform particle size, uniform shape, and it should be colorless. Adsorbent should have high degree of mechanical stability, and it should be cost effective. So these are the characteristics of adsorbents, means adsorbent should not be reactive, it should not give any catalytic reaction. Particle size of adsorbents should be uniform, and shape should be uniform, and it should be colorless in appearance, and it should have high degree of mechanical stability. Apart from this, it should be cost effective, means it should not be costly. Okay, now coming to the silica gel, this one which is most commonly used adsorbent in column chromatography. So silica gel H is used for column chromatography purpose, and particle size for silica gel H will be between 125 micron to 250 micron. So diameter of 60 mesh size is 250 micrometer and the diameter of 120 mesh size is 125 micrometer. And the nature of silica gel is acidic in nature. And ratio of stationary phase and analyte should be 20 to 50. Okay, it means if we want to load 1 gram of analyte or 1 gram of mixture compound, then we have to take minimum of 20 gram of silica gel and it should be up to 50 gram of silica gel. If we are increasing the weight of or ratio of adsorbents, then separation will be better. So ratio between substance and adsorbents would be 1:20 to 50, and greater ratio of adsorbents gives better separation. Now coming to the packing of the columns. Column can be packed by two methods. First one is wet packing and the second one is dry packing. So in wet packing, first we will take a mobile phase and then we will suspend our stationary phase into that mobile phase, and it will convert into the form of slurry, and we will properly mix that slurry to remove presence of any air bubble, because it may interrupt our separation. Then that slurry will be poured from upper side of the column, and ultimately our stationary phase will be settled down. But before pouring, first we will divide our column into 5 parts, and the 3/5 part of the column will be filled by stationary phase, and the rest 2/5 part will be remain for our mobile phase. So here you can see I have divided our column into 5 parts, that one green one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we will fill our stationary phase up to this level. Okay, so when we will pour our slurry from upper side of the column, our adsorbent will be settled down. For example, our adsorbent is green in color and our mobile phase is blue in color, then mobile phase will be filled like this. And after that, slowly our stationary phase will be settled down. So after first fraction, this much of stationary phase is settled. After that, we will again pour the slurry, then again stationary phase will be settled up to the higher level. Okay, so in wet packing, we will use the suspended adsorbents in the form of slurry. So in dry packing, directly we will put our adsorbent into the column from upper side, and it will be settled up to the certain level, up to the defined level, and after that we will pour the mobile phase from upper side of the column, and the mobile phase will run from upside to the bottom due to gravitational force, but it will take more time as compared to this wet packing, and there may be, by using dry packing, there may be chances of bubbles. That is why dry packing is not commonly used, only wet packing method is preferred one. Now coming to the mobile phase used in column chromatography. So for mobile phase or solvent system in column chromatography, first we have to develop our solvent system in TLC, and I have already discussed in my previous video for development of solvent system is TLC. Link is given here. You can see that video for development. And after development of solvent system in TLC, same solvent system or same composition or ratio will be applied in column. So solvent system is developed by TLC, and that same solvent system is used in column chromatography, and we can change the ratio of solvent system gradually for better separation of our compounds. So this is the overview about stationary phase and mobile phase used in column chromatography. Now in next video I will discuss about the methodology of column chromatography. Thank you.